วิทยาการหลังการเก็บเกี่ยวแห่งชาติครั้งที่18นะคะตอนนี้เราหลังจากที่เราพักเบรกกันเป็นเวลาประมาณสัก40นาทีแล้วนะคะรายการต่อไปนะคะจะเป็นการบรรยายพิเศษโดยวิทยากรรับเชิญนะคะดร.ไซมอนยันเดอร์ฮูดนะคะสำหรับดร.ไซมอนนะคะปัจจุบันท่านเป็น Managing Boardของกลุ่มบริษัท East West 4นะคะอีกตำแหน่งหนึ่งก็คือท่านเป็น Chief Research and Development Officer ของบริษัท East West 4เช่นเดียวกันนะคะท่านดร.ไซมอนนะคะเป็นผู้เชี่ยวชาญทางด้านปรับปรุงพันธุ์พืชนะคะท่านมีประสบการณ์ทำงานยาวนานมากกว่า 30-40 ปีแล้วนะคะปัจจุบันก็ท่านเป็นส่วนหนึ่งของความสำเร็จของกลุ่มบริษัท East West 4ซึ่งเป็นบริษัทผลิตเมล็ดพันธุ์ผักที่ดีที่สุดในโลกแห่งหนึ่งเลยนะคะวันนี้นะคะท่านก็จะมาแบ่งปันประสบการณ์ในการทำงานวิจัยทางด้านนี้มานะคะโดยวันนี้ท่านจะมาบรรยายให้ฟังเรื่องของ Vegetable Crop Breeding for Extend Shelf Life โดยท่านดร.ไซมอนจะบรรยายประมาณ 30-35 นาทีนะคะผ่านระบบเว็บวินาของเราระหว่างที่ท่านบรรยายนะคะถ้าท่านผู้เข้าร่วมรับฟังสัมมนาท่านใดมีข้อสงสัยสามารถสอบถามเข้ามาทางช่องแชทบ็อกซ์นะคะขอรบกวน เตรียมคำถามเป็นภาษาอังกฤษนะคะพิมพ์คำถามเข้ามาเป็นภาษาอังกฤษนะคะแล้วเดี๋ยวทางผู้บรรยายก็จะตอบเป็นภาษาอังกฤษนะคะเดี๋ยวทาง MC จะรวบรวมคำถามแล้วก็ส่งให้ท่านอาจารย์ไซมอนนะคะหรือถ้าจะถามมาเป็นภาษาไทยเดี๋ยวก็จะแปลภาษาอังกฤษให้นะคะซึ่งท้ายรายการหลังจากอาจารย์บรรยายเสร็จนะคะเราจะมีเวลาตอบคำถามประมาณสัก10นาทีนะคะงั้นก็กติกานะคะก็รับฟังแล้วก็ส่งคำถามเข้ามาทางแชทนะคะตอนนี้ท่านอาจารย์ไซมอนดร.ไซมอน you ready for presentation please welcome Dr. Simon Janderhoop
สวัสดีครับทุกท่านThank you, especially Dr. Yawalak, Dr. Denai, for the opportunity to present some of the results and the impact of what we have done at East West Seed, and specifically on breeding for extended shelf life. Farmers are at the core of, at the heart of everything we do. And if we can make farmers happy, East West Seed can develop a sustainable business. That's really our purpose and our mission. And I'd like to start the presentation with a short story about a happy tomato farmer in India growing a new variety that we introduced last year called Shreya. Farmer's name is Anudeep in the state of Andhra Pradesh. Last year he grew this variety for the first time, quite a big farm, 10 acres. That resulted in an income of $150,000. Not bad. And that's what makes us happy, makes the farmers happy. And this variety specifically has high yield potential, good resistance to foliar diseases, and consistent uniform fruits. And what is relevant also for this conference is this variety also is something that the traders appreciate very much because it has improved firmness. So transportability of this variety is much better than the market leading variety in the market. In this presentation, I would briefly touch on the background, the history of East West Seed. A little bit about breeding. Breeding is more than just breeding for extended shelf life. Some examples of varieties that have extended shelf life and that became market leading varieties. Opportunities to further work on genetic improvement of extended shelf life and conclusions. First, the company, East West Seed. The company was established in 1982. By Simon Groot, an expert seedsman from the Netherlands, who started a new business in this part of the world. And we focus on the tropics only. We don't have any business in Europe. I arrived in Thailand in 1984. You see in a picture of me in my younger days, in the early days of East West Seed. But what we have achieved, we developed the business from scratch. We had nothing in the beginning. The first 10 years were very difficult to establish the brand name, develop products. But after the first 10 years, we developed into the leading vegetable seed company in Southeast Asia, and also developed into one of the bigger companies in India. This was recognized in 2019 by the World Food Prize, when Mr. Simon Grote was awarded the World Food Prize for his role in empowering millions of smallholder farmers to earn higher incomes through better quality seeds. And not only that, also there is an access to seed index, that an independent body that measures also, it compares different seed companies and how they serve smallholder farmers across the world. And also 2019, I think it was the second index, first index we were also number one, but in 2019 again, ISA Seed was recognized as the number one company in serving smallholder farmers. Plant breeding is really the core of the company. The plant breeding is certainly in vegetable crops is complex. We have to look at many different traits, and not all these traits are equally important in all vegetable crops, but many are. And yield is always important. And yield you can break down in yield components like number of fruits, fruit weight, but also plant architecture. Adaptability, earliness play an important role in yield performance. Yield is always important, and that's an important trait for farmers. How the product looks, very important for the trait and for the consumer. Uniformity, color, shape, eating quality in vegetables, very important. Flavor, taste, chemistry, nutritional value, texture. In some crops more important than in others, but in a crop like watermelon, a poor tasting and not very sweet watermelon will not do much in the market. Resistance tolerance, and also an important component that contributes to yield improvement because of high incidence of pests and diseases, fungi, bacteria, viruses, but also environmental stress, very important. And last but certainly not least, shelf life transportability. That the products, the spoilers of products, firmness, water loss, and it's very difficult to capture exactly what shelf life is in different crops, because also storage and transportation conditions play a big role there. But this is the topic of the talk, the shelf life transportability. So ISA Seed, what I mentioned already, has developed into the leading vegetable seed company in tropical Asia. Breeding for improved shelf life has always been very important and still is. It's a high priority. So the question here is, to what extent did breeding for improved shelf life contribute to the successful development of ISA Seed? That was also a nice question for me to look into, because breeding for shelf life is important, but how important has it been in the past? So I look back at all the major variety introductions since the beginning, since the early years, and compared how these the main factors that contributed to the success of these varieties. And in the varieties that were introduced before 2000, 60% of these varieties had an important shelf life or transportability improvement, much better than the market leading variety at the time. In the period, in the 10 years from 2001 to 2010, that reduced to 35%. And in the last 10 years, that is 17%. it might look that shelf life is becoming less important, but that is not the case. I think this is really more an indication that the standards for shelf life in the market have increased and that it is more difficult to improve, to develop further improvements on shelf life. A couple of examples of significant variety introductions where shelf life played an important role, or maybe the most important role. And the first one is a red onion variety that we introduced in the Philippines in 1989. Onion is a very important crop, maybe one of the most important crop, vegetable crops in the Philippines. There's only one season per year that you can grow onions during the cool, dry season. But people like to eat onion year round. So onions are generally stored in cold storages for the rest of the year. But what we noticed already quite early on was that the variety that was planted, Red Creole, after 6 months in storage, there was already 50% yield loss. So we started the program right away by selecting onion bulbs that store better. And that's not a quick progress. Onion is a slow crop. One cycle, one breeding cycle, one generation takes 2 years. But we did that for three cycles, so 6 years. And that resulted in our first onion variety introduction in the Philippines, Red Pinoy. And we did a comparison. In that comparison, Red Pinoy had 23% storage loss after 6 months, and the Czech variety Red Creole 56. So that was a significant improvement, and that showed also in sales, because Red Pinoy and 10 years later or so, we developed an improved version, Super Pinoy, had become the gold standard for onion growers in the Philippines, and still is a very important product there. This is an open pollinated variety, not a hybrid. A couple of pictures to see on the left, storage, cold storage conditions, good bulbs, and rotting and sprouting that happens after so many months in storage. Red Pinoy was developed in the Philippines, Sweet 16, another variety that was introduced in the Philippines, but bred in Thailand. So this variety did not have immediate big impact, but slowly but surely replaced the local open pollinated variety Sugar Baby. And the main factors that contributed to its success were that this variety was much better for off-season growing during the rainy season, better disease tolerance. And secondly, maybe that was even more important, certainly in a country like the Philippines with transportation constraints between islands, putting produce on ships, it takes a long time before produce reaches markets. So, and Sweet 16 has a storage life of around 16 to 20 days, while Sugar Baby spoils in a matter of 5 to 7 days. So a very significant improvement. This gives an impression of how we breed melons. This is not, it's partly also looking at shelf life, but also evaluating quality. Selected fruits are displayed in a barn and then evaluated by the breeder one by one. Another example from Thailand, Superhot. Maybe the name is familiar. It became also a big success, not only in Thailand, but also in many countries in Southeast Asia and China, actually. And these pricky new type varieties in Thailand, every province, every ampere has its own distinct type. And that's always one of the things breeders need to develop what the market needs. And we always had the discussion, should we develop an these separate types for all these different market segments or not? So what we decided, I think we said, let's forget about this. Let's develop this to something that's a little bit different, but of course it needs higher yields. But an important aspect also that we focused on right away on shelf life improvement. And that is really the main thing behind the success of Superhot, that this variety really had a superior shelf life compared to local varieties as a result of thicker fruit wall, also more glossy, a thicker pedicel that dries out more slowly, and firm fruits. And firm fruits is also is not very clear in the picture, I think, but some of the fruits are more hollow, and some of the fruits are more filled with seeds, and that's an important characteristic also. On the pictures on the left-hand side also, you see also some, it went hand-in-hand also with maybe better post-harvest handling by, certainly by exporters, rather than packing them in plastic bags, putting them in carton boxes with better aeration. But this has been, I think also has contributed, I don't have numbers on export of fresh produce from Thailand, but I know Superhot was a favorite export produce for many producers who exported to Japan, to Europe. Big white, Waxicorn. Waxicorn is an amylopectin corn. The field corn has amylose and amylopectin. Waxicorn, like glutinous rice, has amylopectin mainly or only, and is a favorite vegetable corn in Thailand, Vietnam, China. Isaseed was the first company to have success with a hybrid introduction, and maybe other companies have tried, but we had a big success. This became a market-leading product in a big way, replacing local open-pollinated varieties. And the main thing, besides yield performance, was shelf life. And shelf life here is a little bit complex, and we've now termed that stay soft. And it's that stay soft trait contributes to a longer harvest window. Local varieties, if you don't harvest at the right day, maybe you can extend it by one day, but if you go beyond that, the kernels are hard, you cannot eat the corn anymore. A second aspect of this trait is post-harvest storability of the fresh ears. The local varieties, you had to prepare and cook and eat within one day. Big white, you can store for 3 days. And finally, say preparing starch, I think it's, this is, I'm not a starch expert, but cooking starch, you get a gel, and gels break down at one point. And that can happen through different processes, but one of these is a cold cycle. Local varieties, if a trader in the market is boiling ears and trying to sell it, but sometimes at the end of the day they cannot finish it. They put it in the refrigerator, but the next day the local variety is inedible. The kernels are hard, and even if you cook it again, it remains hard. Well, big white, after one day in the refrigerator, it's still soft. So that was a major improvement and contributed to the success of this variety. The last example, an eggplant in the Philippines, released in 2013. Again, this variety, I think the main success factor was superior shelf life. And in addition to that also, it has high yield potential, longer fruits than the market leader at that time, which was Casino, another east-west variety in the Philippines, and good bacterial wilt resistance. The picture is maybe not super clear, but it shows also Fortuner after 6 days in storage, ambient storage, skin is still tight and smooth, while Casino is shriveled and wrinkled. So a major improvement. As we've seen already, say, in the early years, we seem to have more success with improvements in shelf life. And the reason for that is that, say, the benchmark, the standards at that time were low. Local varieties generally had poor shelf life. And then with relatively little effort, you can identify improvements and achieve improvements in improved shelf life. Now the standards are higher, so it's a little bit more difficult, but still there is, we have not exhausted the natural variation, the genetic variation in all the crops that we work in yet. So there are opportunities. It only takes maybe a little bit more effort to look for improvements in shelf life. And also in the last 20 years, 15 years, there have been developments on know-how, on functional know-how of genes has improved very rapidly. And yeah, through mutations, you can also achieve improved shelf life through knockouts or other ways. And that is something we're pursuing at this time. Gene editing, another form, still a little bit controversial and not regulated, at least not allowed yet in this part of the world. But gene editing will also offer lots of opportunities to create improvements in shelf life. And I show two pictures at the bottom, one tomato, it's the Alcobaca gene, and a shelf life, an extended shelf life gene that is applied by many tomato breeders across the world. And lettuce, that is a specialty of a lettuce breeder in the Netherlands. It's called, they call the trait Nox. And yeah, if you look closely on the left-hand side, you see this is cut lettuce, fresh produce in the supermarket. Cut produce is a popular item. But when you cut on the cut surface, you get oxidation and browning or pinking. This company, this breeder, identified a mutation, a natural variation in lettuce or a related species that did not have this phenomenon. And that's a major improvement because if your cut lettuce looks fresh after 1 day in the supermarket, I think that's a big improvement. So there are plenty of opportunities still out there. And my final question, do we need a GMO long shelf life trait in vegetables? I think no. There are plenty of other opportunities to create and develop further improvements. So in conclusion, breeding for extended shelf life has contributed significantly to the success of East-West Seed and will continue to be an important component of the East-West breeding programs. So during the first 20 to 30 years, quick wins to improve shelf life were possible due to relatively low standards and the availability of of germplasm with improved shelf life. In many crops, we've seen significant genetic improvements for shelf life. Still, there are opportunities out there that we're looking into and developing. And I'm not sure East West is certainly not the only company. Shelf life transportability is important for all vegetable breeders. It will continue to play an important role, and there's still plenty of opportunity to improve shelf life in many of the crops we're working on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Simon, for your wonderful presentation and addressing us the importance of breeding technology that help to enhance the post-harvest quality as well as extend the storage life. So from now on, we would like to have some few questions for you. Could you please give us the example of what is the best or the most successful products that East West Seed developed and in the case of extend the most longest storage life and very popular nowadays? And
the most successful product that East West developed, and the second?
For example, what is the example that we can see in the market nowadays?
Say the most successful product is Red Pinoy is very important, but that is very local, Philippines. Maybe a second example of a very successful product is Suprema or Arjuna Pumpkin. It's the same variety. Sometimes we sell varieties under different names in different countries. That is also a variety we developed around 1990, and that is still a market leading variety in many markets, including now we're starting to get some traction in East Africa. Africa is our next market that we're trying to develop. So that's a big one. In Thailand, I must say East West has always been quite strong in this Vexicorn. Big White is maybe already out of the market, but we have Sweet White and a combination of Vexicorn and Sweet Corn that is very popular in the market. And we have many new varieties that in that same market segment. And secondly, bitter gourd, Mara, is important, which is not a very big crop in Thailand. And cucumber, big green, is a very famous cucumber variety among Thai cucumber growers, and maybe not very well known by consumers. And that is maybe a point of marketing. If you can really get maybe consumers to remember names, I think that also strengthens your brand and your recognition in the market.
I have one question. In term of breeding, post-harvest and marketing, they have to set a goal for if you want to improve the shelf life of tomato. For a breeder, you set a goal in your mind that tomato should last at least 14 days, 21 days for post-harvest. But I just wonder, what is the marketing want? How long market want or consumer want for how long their product should last? How can you meet the goal from breeder, post-harvest and market few together? How can you merge them all and decide we have to improve this product for grower and for consumer?
I hope I get the question right, but setting breeding targets. So that is always a difficult thing. But what we do now, if we start a breeding project now, we have to start thinking about what the market needs in 5 to 10 years from now, because developing a new variety takes at least 5 years, and then you need a number of years to test and start selling, and it takes time. So yeah, getting market feedback, it's relatively easy to get market feedback on what the market needs now. But what the market needs in 5 to 10 years from now, that is difficult, and not so many people have thought about that. But that is always the challenge of us commercial breeders trying to engage with different stakeholders in the market, farmers, traders, consumers, and trying to match that also with genetic possibilities, because sometimes a trader or a consumer wants something, but is that genetically possible? So that is indeed one of the big challenges to set breeding targets that are achievable and doable. A good breeder can do that, but they need help from indeed capable colleagues in marketing and stakeholders in the market overall. I hope that addresses the question.
Thank you, because I'm very admire from, because you're breeding now and the product maybe in next 5 years, it might be popular or it's not work out. It's kind of gambling for success as well. That's why the market and the consumer feedback is very important information nowadays when you want to improve something, right?
Thank you. Yeah, and not so, because you have to set breeding targets and you have to take some calculated guesses on what is possible and what creates value for the market. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. But that is part of life. That is. But I think we have been quite successful in doing the right things. But certainly we have also seen plenty of failures. Yeah, but it's better to fail and learn and move on than to not try.
Thank you. It's very challenging.
Well, I do have one more question about the waxy corn. It is very interesting result. The stay soft variety or the stay soft cultivar, I see you can expand harvesting window up to about 3 days, which is very useful for harvesters and packing house management. So you can extend the longer harvesting time. So in your opinion, it is possible to extend the harvesting window in the longer time, like up to 5 days or 7 days? And if it is possible, will it affect the post-harvest quality of the waxy corn?
The last question, the last part.
If you can extend the harvesting window of the waxy corn, for example, up to 5 or 7 days, will it affect the post-harvest quality of the waxy corn later then?
Yeah, that I do not dare to say for sure whether it's possible. It might be possible, but I think, say, if we can find the right genotype that delivers maybe an even longer harvesting window, I think that will also have an impact on longer storability. But again, sometimes, what does storability exactly mean? Because another aspect of storability is how it looks. If the husk stays green or whether it turns yellow, because maybe that has no impact on eating quality, but it has an impact on how it looks. And that's a different aspect of storability. And there are also genetic differences we've already observed for, say, stay green husk or husk that turns yellow after 1 or 2 days after harvesting.
Okay, then thank you very much for your...
Dr. Simon.
Well, หลังจากนี้นะครับก็ขอขอบพระคุณดร. ไซมอน ยันเดอร์ฮูปนะครับสำหรับการนำเสนอที่น่าสนใจมากนะครับในบรรยายพิเศษครั้งนี้ครับผมขอบพระคุณครับ